Can you just talk into that for a minute?
Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing, 1, 2, 3, testing.
Okay, members, good evening. Welcome to the Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee meeting that I declare open Tuesday 1st of September. The Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee and the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee, which will be held following, will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed or published publicly by the Council, including transferring outside of Australia. Members, I acknowledge that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pay respect to Elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land, acknowledging that they have continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Members, I have no apologies or leave of absence. I think we're all here. Item number three, I'll call for confirmation of minutes from the 4th of August, Deputy Lord Mayor, seconded by the Lord Mayor. If I don't have anyone speaking, I'll put that. All those in favour, declare those meetings minutes carried. Members, I have no public forum under agenda item number 4. And members, we actually have no deputations under agenda item number 5. In my verbal report, I'll just cover on two very brief issues. There's item number 11 on this agenda has been withdrawn for this evening's meeting. And I just wanted to quickly also flag with you item number 12, letting you all know that this report was actually written prior to the briefing we had recently. So if there was a bit more information, we've had a bit more information in that briefing. So I just wanted to flag with you that that report was actually written prior to that briefing, if you've got any queries on that. I'll now call for items for adoption on block. Now, item number 8, we have a presentation, so I'm going to pull that out. Item number 9, Councillor Wilkinson. Item number 10, Councillor Wilkinson. Item number 12. And item number 13. Okay, members, I'll call for someone to move items 12 and 13. Councillor Martin, Councillor Corbell seconding. I'll put those items, all those in favour, declared that carried. Now I invite Rick Hutchins, who is here, item number 8, and Donna Ferretti. Oh, right, yes, welcome. Now we actually have an item. I'll ask you to do your presentation first, Rick, and then we'll move to the recommendation.
Sure, thank you. Thank you, members. Now, I'll just give a very brief introduction, then hand over to Donna to present and lay to us questions if there's a need. Just by way of background, this presentation relates to item 8 on your agenda. There's a report from Donna as attachment C in your papers. This paper and the three papers that are attached to the report come through previous resolutions from council around council developing a planning study to inform in the longer term a local planning strategy, but also, I guess, inform council's response to the current planning reform process. We understand now, and some members may have heard, that I understand the minister will introduce a bill into parliament next week. So it's not far away in terms of starting the legislative process for planning reform. So part of this, I guess the reason tonight is to bring some papers around the work we're doing to help council in terms of future planning reform matters. So I guess I'll hand over now to Donna and run through the presentation.
Terrific. Thank you, Rick, and thank you, members, for allowing me this opportunity to speak to you today. We're going to whip through fairly quickly because you do have the paper in your agenda papers. So if you have any questions as I run through it quickly, please feel free to interrupt and we can have a conversation about it. Could I ask that the next slide be put on, please? And I'll probably have to pepper that. Great. This slide is basically about the engagement requirements in the existing system. Very quickly, they are effectively summarised by written submissions and public meetings. As noted in the report, these kinds of engagement mechanisms are not well regarded now with engagement. Basically, people don't regard them as very, very highly as meaningfully engaging the community or any other sector for that matter. And what it does tend to do is lead to adversarial us and them kinds of situations which tend to get amplified in public meetings. And what it can do in a council situation is basically mean that residents are against council and residents are against developers, and it's a very much a clash, which isn't a very good forum in which to actually work out different interests and how you might negotiate your way through them. If we look at the next slide, in terms of the IAP, the Institute of International Federation of Public Participation spectrum, at the moment we are effectively in the two left sides of those two columns, which are generally regarded as being the least favourable engagement mechanisms. That's where we are at the moment. Where we would like to be is certainly towards the right of the column, preferably in the involve and collaborate. I know of no organisation that's managed to empower their residents in the way that that particular spectrum suggests, but we certainly wanted to get into the involve and collaborate. Next slide, please. In terms of the proposed reforms, the expert panel has tended to lay quite a great deal of emphasis on this charter of citizen participation. I'll be brutally frank with you because I was involved in much of this work. The expert panel were quite endeared to what New South Wales were doing at the time, and they proposed a charter of this sort. New South Wales, interestingly, have actually retreated from that position because what the charter is intended to do is to get engagement up front in the planning and strategic and policy setting sides of this process, and with the assumption being that that would mean that people would not need to be involved at the DA or development assessment side of things. And that is a problematic assumption in my view. Even when I'm involved in strategic policy setting, if someone was going to propose a development next to me that was, I thought, was going to have serious impacts, I would want to have to say something about that. And so that assumption is problematic on that basis and is the reason why the New South Wales government has actually retreated from there. The charter is also intended to be less prescriptive, more flexible, which I certainly endorse. It needs to be tailored to the particular engagement exercise that council may wish to run. It will be developed by the proposed State Planning Commission, but other than that, there's actually very little details about the charter other than this focus on outcomes. So next slide, please, which I've argued is actually a little bit problematic because I don't know of any good outcome that has come from flawed process. So the emphasis on outcomes as opposed to process is a bit problematic. Also, there are problems associated with having a one-size-fits-all kind of approach. Now, I'm not saying that this will happen with the Charter, but it's something certainly to look out for. You know, we talk often about integrated economies, integrated environments. The social body is not like that. We have a very, very highly differentiated social body that needs to be catered for, and you can't cater for a differentiated social body with a one-size-fits-all kind of prescriptive approach. And of course, the Charter looks like it could actually handball quite a lot of work onto councils and developing engagement plans, etc., that may well slow down planning decisions. Next slide, please. In terms of development assessment, most of what the panel has said about that isn't about consultation per se, but they talk about simplifying development pathways. And what they're trying to achieve there is to get a significant reduction in merit assessments. Those of you that understand the development process, we do a lot of merit assessments, and that triggers notification to the public for some developments. What the panel wants to do is virtually cut a swathe through merit assessment and put a great deal more of those into the complying pathway, which means no public notification. They have reasons for doing that, and that is that a lot of routine kinds of developments may not need to be notified, but a look at some great work that your planners have done in relation to documenting notification of current developments. There obviously needs to be a bit of work done in that area, certainly to actually review the triggers for notification and look at what should be notification and what doesn't need to be notified, and I talk about that a little bit later. Next slide, please. So in summary, and I've basically summarised this, there is an assumption that engagement at the strategic and policy stages will mitigate the need to engage at the assessment stage. Problematic. And there is the assumption that we'll reduce development subject to merit assessment, and that's going to see less public notification and less appeal rights. Next slide, please. So what we did then was look at what might be more desired ways of engaging the public, and certainly you can't go far, so you can't really go beyond the public, the deliberative kind of like public engagement mechanisms that is talked about at length in the literature, certainly supported by the International Association of Public Participation, and has been used to good effect by your own council in a number of cases. What that does is bring together the expert top-down knowledge with the community, and it engages both experts as well as community people to actually learn, talk to each other, talk about their particular interests and learn from each other. This is this process of social learning, which basically means that people get to know each other and think, well, hang on, I hadn't thought about that perspective. So they're far more amenable to thinking about their own views in that context and maybe changing their views. Some people call it an interest-based approach to engagement. And that certainly should, as I've mentioned on that side, involve decision makers as being a pretty critical thing. So decision makers, your DAP panel members, for instance, could actually learn from community views as well as learn from applicant and developer views as well, and actually work out how you negotiate around some of the tensions that might be involved. Next slide, please. These deliberative public engagement approaches are very well suited to strategic policy development, and the IDC's Adelaide 5000 project was a really good example of that, as I've noted in the report, as well as the Picture Adelaide. I'd say the Picture Adelaide for the way in which it engaged on social media platforms in particular. And I'm currently working on your parkland strategy, and the outcomes of that exercise have been just fantastic. But I'd argue they could also be productively involved in DA if we actually made developers and applicants a little bit more responsible for communicating what their development is likely to do, what its impacts might be, and they should be engaging with members of the public to actually allay the public's fears and better inform them about what the development is likely to lead to and what they have responded to in actually putting forward the development. Next slide, please. Sure, absolutely.
Certainly our lived experience, isn't it, when someone's doing a development nearby and you start to have a conversation with them and they see how it might impact on you, they're likely to want to change things. But is your suggestion that this be mandated, or is it that you'd... I mean, how would you actually see that working? We'd ask people to engage their community before they bring something to development assessment. Can you talk a bit about that?
We haven't talked about the actual mechanics of that, but certainly I would envisage it being like you've just described, requiring developers, especially of substantial projects, to be able to hold a meeting. In fact, a couple of developers that I talked to have done this quite productively. And to make that, well, you use the word mandatory, but you sort of like make it compulsory. I think developers get away with a lot. And what happens is that planners in that case can't fulfill their, what they're supposed to be mediators here, not to take any sides, and the developers tend to get away with a great deal. They just submit their plans and that's it. They don't actually have to face people and explaining what their plans mean, because as you know, people find it difficult often reading plans and understanding what the likely impacts are likely to be. And it would just be a way in which developers, and good developers certainly would support this approach, that they can get in front of people that are concerned and explain to them exactly what the implications would be of that development on them. In fact, there are cases where developers have done that, and people from the community have been so endeared to the development after having it explained to them that they've gone and bought dwellings out of the development. So it's actually been quite, it can be a good marketing exercise for developers at the same time. One developer argued, well, if we're going to have to do that, we would want some incentive, as they would tend to do. And I've suggested that an incentive would be they wouldn't have to face extra, you know, development fees, for instance, for doing it and things of that nature. But those mechanics, I think, need to be worked through. And I would suggest that they need to be worked through with the development sector as well. So you can, you know, you're actually using deliberative public engagement techniques to actually devise what might be a public engagement solution.
Donna, are you happy to take, given that your presentation is sort of structured around certain topics, are you happy to take questions as we go whilst the topic is on the screen?
Absolutely.
Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Chair. On the matter of notification, I mean, I'm in the development field. Over 60% of my work is residential property development, apartments and townhouses, and clients of mine who are developers are surprised at how little notification, you know, they're surprised that that we're doing a development of six townhouses and no one around is notified. Yet in other council areas they are, and if two points are joined, they get called a block of flats, and then they get category three appeal rights as well to boot, but in other areas no notification whatsoever. And so it's quite inconsistent, but they're not, it's only volume home builders that wanted to probably do substandard buildings in nice areas that don't want the notification, with everyone saying it's not good enough for the area. They're probably the people lobbying for the lack of notification. And then we often would do our own consultation, like you mentioned, because we want to get people on side. And if you can get a buyer out of it, that's all the better. But then on the thing about the prescription, the more prescription versus less prescription, most developer clients of mine want the prescription. They want to know what they can and can't do before they buy the site. So this whole, so it's interesting, the New South Wales experience where they've retracted from that John Hanlon no prescription approach, which is
we're sticking to questions here, and we don't need to go into that.
I'm pleased to see that the New South Wales has picked up that experience, because that's certainly been mine, that developers are not wanting this sort of flexible approach, which really is lack of idea of what people can do with their sites before they commit to how much they pay for it. I'm just in your perspective on that.
Councillor, I'm not saying prescription in relation to what you can do with the site. I was talking about prescription in relation to public
engagement. Sure.
We've got a slide. Actually, if you could go to the last slide, which is specifically about notification. The second to last slide, penultimate slide. Looking at the notification site, as you pointed out, it is enormously problematic in terms of its inconsistency. We looked at stuff where there was, you know, quite clearly a very substantial development that you think should be notified but wasn't, or there was a change of use application which shouldn't have been notified but was. So in that sense, those inconsistencies are replete, not just in this council, it's across the board, across South Australia. So we workshopped with planning staff some of the notification options, and we came up with these kinds of things where you were looking at, okay, council staff would determine what the likely impacts would be, and so people that would likely be directly impacted by a development should be notified in the context of what you would expect in the zone, a very important caveat to that particular requirement. You notify by letter, email, not the newspaper, which is a very old-fashioned, kind of like 1993 kind of look requirement. You place notices on the site of development. Now, the expert panel were quite endeared to that, I might add. However, it suddenly dropped off the equation when the South Australian government looked at it. So what has happened is the expert panel recommendations have gone to the government and they've had another go at it, and they've obviously not liked this notices. So this is something that I think we should actually put back on the table.
Yeah.
And the other thing is putting the boundary issues, fencing disputes, things that take up enormous amounts of energy, to get that out of the planning
civil
system.
Matters.
And that should be dealt with by the South Australian Civil and Administrative Tribunal. Yeah. Exactly. So that's how Councillor Wilkinson would deal with that kind of like requirement. Look, I could just stop there and go for questions, because the last few slides are on the engagement principles, which are in the paper, and how they could be applied in both a strategic policy setting, and I've already talked about how they could be applied in a development assessment kind of setting. So I'm happy to take questions, discussion points at this point, Madam Chair.
Great. Thank you, Donna. And thanks, Rick. I'll ask for questions. We're not debating. We still have a recommendation to consider before us, so I'll ask anyone, Councillor Martin, a question on the presentation.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Look, Donna, I'm going to embarrass myself and ask you to tell me your background, because I don't know you. I'm a new member of council, but you probably know to everyone.
Beg your pardon, Councillor. Rick actually said that I should do that, but I thought, oh no, everybody knows me. I've been in the planning game for over 30 years. I've taught quite a few people in this room. I was an academic for 18 years teaching planning at the University of South Australia. I then went and worked at GHD and ran their planning area for a number of years. Went out on my own as a sole trading consultant, and then was tapped on the shoulder and worked in the state government for 4 years from 2011 till last year, and was basically involved with the expert panel's work. And then I left the government this time last year, and council then engaged me to do the study. So, yes, beg your pardon, sir.
I have a supplementary
question. Can you use your microphone, please?
Oh, sorry. I'm never sure when to use it. Sorry, Chair. I want to take you back to that first slide. And you talked about where we were on the scale of participation. Yes. And you suggested we're at the back end there. And I'm a bit confused, because I thought part of the reforms that we're talking about would actually lead to less discussion. That is to say that people's right to engage would be removed. And so I'm not sure that we're actually there. In fact, I'm not sure where we are.
Yeah. At the moment, the expert panel, at the moment there are, our system is such that there's so many merit developments that many do get notified at the development assessment side of things. And so there is public engagement there, but it's very much of an inform kind of nature. It's very much on the left-hand column. What the panel is seeking to do is to get people involved, and potentially in a collaboration kind of way, of developing policy and strategy, which then filters down to the development plan, which is the policy setting, which the expert panel is arguing will therefore mean that people won't need to be engaged at the development assessment side of things. Now, I would question the veracity of that assumption, and I would question the panel's desire to get people out of the development assessment side of things, because I think that's where effectively, as they say, the rubber hits the road, and people need to understand what's going to be happening close to them. They also need to be involved at the strategy side, so that they understand, or people do understand, okay, I can expect development of this type in my neighbourhood, but then if a development comes along that sort of like is a little bit out of kilter with what citizens have imagined that development to be like, then they need to have the right to say something. And so that's effectively what we're arguing here.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I'm with you.
Thank you, that's good.
Councillor Clarahan.
Thank you for your presentation. It's very uplifting, given that a lot of what we fear is that people will be totally disempowered in the planning system. And having been in the area of planning, etc., for a long time, you understand, well, do you understand the difficulty of getting people involved at the policy level?
Absolutely.
And the challenges, and also it's not just that, but also the necessary resourcing will be quite significant.
Absolutely. It will absolutely be important, yeah. In terms of that, that's why the deliberative approaches are so good, because it gives an opportunity, say if council were to take on deliberative public engagement, for council to be able to almost I don't want to use the word educate, but sort of like let people know, okay, this is how the planning system works. A lot of people don't engage because they don't understand how it works. And this affords council an opportunity through exercises like Picture Adelaide to devise forums where people can actually get engaged and understand how the planning system works, so they can understand what their role has been in developing policy and strategy. I find that quite exciting. The key thing, though, it needs to be really well facilitated. You've got to have really able facilitators to do this work. I have enormous respect for staff of council in the planning area, and I have no doubt that that will be able to be done, but it's imperative that people that these forums are well facilitated so people can engage and then understand and learn about how the system operates so they can then influence it.
And one more question. I noted in the report, and I'm sorry I can't find it, you consulted with various groups, etc., in the preparation of this report. Did you speak with any local resident groups?
Unfortunately, I've had reschedule after reschedule, so I'll be speaking with people next week and the week after. And what will happen is we'll addend that to the report, the outcomes of those discussions to the report.
Yes. And finally, just a question about the sort of the meeting of the desire to have people involved at the policy level and to value their input as well as increase their understanding, but also the government's desire to push through policy irrespective of where people are at. How do you see us working on those two levels, where we're, the government and the panel are saying involve more people at the policy level, but we're also getting messages from the state government to say, I want this policy to be this. So there's a bit of a misfit there.
There is a total gap. You're so right.
Okay.
And the expert panel have been quite silent on the development plan amendment process, which in its engagement, ironically, most people complained about that. And yet it hasn't actually talked about how it intends to improve that process. That process is ridiculous in my view. It has become completely outrageous and a burden, not just on councils, but also on DIPTI itself. And I would be looking to see what the bill says about that very closely, because I think that's something that council can certainly represent their views to the Minister about. In fact, I'm working currently with Victor Harbour Council, who have had one development plan amendment that I've been working on for some time, refused by the Minister with very, very little justification for doing so. And I'm sure I don't need to remind councillors here about what happened when the Minister put the recent development plan amendment on interim operation. Again, the expert panel talked about that, but they haven't actually talked very much about how they intend to respond to it. So, yes, we need to keep a watching brief on this one.
So how would be the best way of addressing that issue?
Wait to see the bill, I think, and then we'd need to respond to what's proposed there.
Yeah. Right. Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. As a former pupil of Donna, I can vouch for Donna's prowess. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Your Worship.
Donna, you mentioned a great piece of work done by, I wasn't quite sure, Bill Clements, I think you mentioned in your preamble. Was that correct? You said regarding...
I can't remember, Your Worship.
In your preamble, you mentioned there was a very good piece of work, and I think it was around the consultation piece, or it was the model, which you said...
Oh, a deliberative and public engagement. Yes, there was an author by the name of Clements that I looked at, yes.
Right,
most definitely.
Okay.
Yep.
Why was that person's work so preeminent?
Because they certainly argued very strongly for the deliberative public engagement mechanism, but they also talked about some of the problems of that approach and the need in particular to ensure it's well executed and well facilitated. I was particularly endeared to that. It's all very well to get a whole group of people in a room talking about something, but unless people are listening to each other and listening to the varied interests in the room, and the only way you can do that is if it's well facilitated, you're not going to get as far as you can. I mean, it's not, it won't be as productive as it could otherwise be. So the imperative, you know, if I was facilitating, and I'm not spruiking myself necessarily, but if I was facilitating a forum of that type, I would make sure that people were listening very carefully to all of the interests that were represented in that room. I would basically expect that decision makers, people like you, would be involved in that, so you could also hear the views of your constituents and you could therefore be in a better position to respond to those. And then you, as elected members, could say, well, we've got these political pressures, etc., etc., so constituents could hear the whole, you know, array of different factors that influence decision making. So it's having that level of conversation. Clayton Ertz, this legal firm in Brisbane, used this approach very effectively. I went to one seminar that they ran, and the person running it said he has dealt with some extremely difficult problems, but not once has he failed to be able to get people to actually come round after conversations and work through their tensions and negotiate their way around them. It does require time as well. But I think the initial resource and time effort that's made is worth it in the long run. It really is. You'll get a much more engaged community.
Right, thank you. Councillor Wilkinson, one last question and then we'll go into the recommendation.
Thank you. In terms of the notification, you talked about the signs on properties and stuff like that. Would you support an approach whereby sort of development that only affects immediate neighbours, like a rear extension, doesn't get notified broadly, you know, it's just immediate neighbours are notified, but something that might involve demolition of a bluestone contributory building in a street that the whole street might care about, that then does get a sign on the front fence saying there's an application to demolish this to build a new development, because everyone in the street might care about that. Mm. To make that kind of distinction between planning that affects immediate neighbours and a planning affects everyone in the street.
Yes, I would support that approach. And basically, certainly use your staff to be able to
make that distinction.
Determine those kinds of decisions.
Yeah, And then the planning consultation. I mean, the move is often say, get the public to put their thing in when we're establishing policy. But notoriously, people don't engage. But it's sort of like speak now or forever hold your peace. But no one really understands the gobbledygook anyway. So no one engages, and we get two people with six staff at a community hall about the planning policy, and then when the DA is lodged, everyone gets up in arms, and then they get told it's too late. So I think having illustrations and things to help engage people in the policy stage. But in
social media platforms. Mm, I mean, your council does that really effectively. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've read all of the material from the Parklands engagement, and having people respond to people's ideas has been fantastic, because you actually get those people engaged, the ideas are really productive, and you can do that in a planning forum. You could certainly do that in policy strategic setting, in planning as well. And it provides respondents, say Rick responding to a member of the public making some idea, Rick could actually say, oh, by the way, did you know that if we did this, that would have this particular effect on the planning system and blah, blah, blah. So you're able to educate and inform at the same time.
Right, thank you, Donna. Thank you, Rick, for your presentation. I'll now, and I'll just note that, you know, we're really nicely forming positions on what the legislation may bring, and when it does come around September 8th, we'll have a firm position that will evolve continually. But thank you for the good work done in the planning team on that. I'll now ask someone to move the recommendation. Councillor Moran, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak? Anyone else? Councillor Hender?
A question about how we might engage, or whether we are engaging, the broader local government community in this conversation, because I think if we're going to have a voice, a powerful voice, we need to be speaking as one. Yep. To the extent that we can.
Sure. Through the chair. There's a number of, I guess, fronts that we're seeking to really engage, particularly on these pieces, but generally within the reform. I'll probably go through some of them. Council administration is on an LGA technical working group and informing planning reform, so we're certainly bringing the work that council has done to date through that forum, but also I guess, adding input where we can and certainly trying to influence the scope of work that the LGA undertakes and then certainly trying to broaden that out. There is an informal network through council offices around particularly the Inner Rim, but some of the other key councils where there is certainly a sharing of data and sort of intent would be to start to certainly feed these reports and work out amongst those groups. And there also is certainly at an officer level an attempt to really disseminate that information as far as we can. We're trying to keep up to date with where things are going and the key inputs and input where we can. The next key stage is with the release of the bill is really, and there is a briefing scheduled for council, I think the week following the release of the bill where we come back to council, where certainly those discussions can happen further with council and more formally and a number of different levels as well.
Just the timing. We've got the bill released on the, what was it, 8th?
Certainly, we understand the 8th.
And then do we know what the schedule of the timing will be after that?
Broadly, I think we would intend to try and confirm that as soon as after the release as possible. But I guess what we do understand is there'll be a sort of initial 4 to 6 week period where the bill will sit within Parliament without moving too far. But I think we need to wait to see the bill, and we understand there'd be information released at the time around how it's intended to progress the bill through Parliament.
Thank you, Rick. All right, members, I'll Councillor Moran, will you sum up? Councillor Moran, summed up. I'll put that. All those in favour, declare that carried. Item number 9, Councillor Wilkinson. Are you moving something, Councillor?
I'm moving as printed, but I've got a question of the administration.
I have to have a seconder, please. Councillor Moran, ask your question.
Thank you. I note the advice that the reason why this was deferred was because there was an original heavy wrought iron palisade removed, and I note the explanation that is actually removed by the previous owners and the property has changed hands such that it's not the responsibility. It's not the current owners who are seeking the grant for this works who did the unauthorised removal. Two questions is, what will we be doing to pursue the reinstatement of the heavy wrought iron fence, and how did it come about that on a state heritage item, a heavy duty wrought iron palisade was removed and replaced with a lightweight powder coated thing without being picked up an enforcement action happening at the time it was removed? Because it shouldn't have happened and it should have been dealt with before it changed hands.
Rick, Michael,
Simon. Thank you, through the chair. Certainly there's no record within council's system of any enforcement action being taken at the time. It was recorded, but there seems to have been no follow-up. The second question was, what are we going to do about it? My understanding is that council must take action within a 12-month period, and it's well and truly outside of that 12-month period for enforcement action to take place.
What
will we be doing in terms of encouraging the new owners to reinstate the...
Mr. Chick?
Through the chair, if I could refer members to paragraph 5.1.2.6, which basically outlines that we'll continue to work with the new owners and encourage and support them in any means possible, including any HIS applications in the future to do that.
Thank you, David. Do I have any other questions or speakers this item? Ask a question.
Could you just go over that again? I wasn't quite clear in response to the question.
Page 65.
By the councillor. Page 65. Yep, I had a look. I couldn't see it.
Councillor Wilkins asked a question about how will administration proactively pursue the reinstatement of I think you referred to specifically the cast iron fence. Cast iron. It refers to it in 5.1.2.6, where there'll be some ongoing work with the applicant or new owner
To reinstate the stonework and the cast iron fence.
Correct.
So the stonework we're actually working with, that's part of this report. As far as the palisade is concerned, we'll continue to work with the new owners to see if in the future they would be amenable to seeing that being replaced to a more suitable palisade fence as well.
Can I ask if the conversation's been had?
That's in the previous.
And the other thing was, in terms of the location of the iron fence?
So
was removed?
I don't know, to be honest, where the original fence has gone. I'm assuming it's probably gone to scrap. It's probably well gone. But as far as the canvassing of that, we have actually done that. Currently, their first priority is around the stone wall, and that's outlined in the previous paragraph in 5.1.2.5. So their higher priority is around the stone itself because of the safety concerns, but we'll continue to work with them on the iron.
Okay.
There's no reason why elected members can't talk to its constituents as well. Lord Mayor, you have a question or you'd like to speak to?
Just a comment, Chair. I'd just like to extend thanks through to administration because I've noticed in this report that we now have the running tally of allocated HAS funding over the course of the financial year, and that's a great measure. So thanks for that inclusion.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Wilkinson, have you summed up?
Just to sum up, I just think this case draws the importance of council's enforcement actions such that if we get to put the fence back, we'll be having to use ratepayers' money to incentivise the new owners to put back what the previous owners never should have been allowed to take out. And our enforcement people should have picked it up at the time that was done and been dealt with, and it could have been required to put the fence back before it got sold off to someone else, rather than us now having to try and incentivise the new owners who had nothing to do with that. So if I just sort of ask, for our planning staff dealing with enforcement to, hear the importance of that enforcement and looking out for unauthorised work, because this is what happens.
All right, thank you for your comments, Councillor Wilkinson. I'm sure they'll take that on notice. Members, I put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Item number 10, Councillor Wilkinson.
This is in terms of the heritage promotions budget.
Yeah, are you moving the recommendation?
Moving it with an amendment that the National Trust online.
Sorry, Councillor Wilkinson. Before, are you is point is paragraph 1 and 2 remaining? Are you adding a third paragraph?
Yeah, yes, that in All addition right. to this, that the National Trust online heritage app be funded out of carry forwards. It's $10,000, and I'm just to state for the record, I'm on the.
We're not talking to it now until you get your words up. So the council funds, I think you're trying to say, the yep. National Trust Online Heritage app
yep.
out of carry forwards. That is
yes.
what you're proposing.
Yep.
Now...
14, 15 carry forwards.
Just no. out of carry forwards, Yeah, do you want to be more specific out of carry 14, forwards?
14/15 carry forwards.
Yeah. Right. Now, before I seek a seconder on that, I'm just going to get some clarity about A, the what work we're doing there already, and B, with the National Trust, and B, the implications of budget on that. Councillor Martin, I'm asking for some clarity on what we're already doing in that space and Because we might already be doing it. So I want to get clarity on that.
Through the chair, what I would suggest is that we can provide some additional information. We just need to find some clarity around between now and next week. We believe that there is about $15,000 in the Connect Adelaide project, and I'll also, yes, for this year, and I'll also note that in paragraph 8 we referred to a carry forward from previous years, which would effectively see that project wrapped up. But we can provide that information in the coming weeks.
So, I mean, members, I do urge you to find out this information before you put up these amendments. But perhaps Lord Wilkinson has put it up. Do I have a seconder on this point 1, 2, and 3? Councillor Martin. You have the floor, Councillor Wilkinson.
Yes.
Well,
yeah. Look, if I could just speak now, but I'll perhaps refer it to the council meeting when we've got the full information. But I'd just like to, for clarification, and just to state that I am on the National Trust Cultural Heritage Advisory Committee, so I'm privy to the work that's being done. There's been an enormous amount of volunteer work done by other honorary members of that committee. And the ask of council assisting this, which is segues, you know, with what we're trying to do in the heritage space, mainly being done by the National Trust through volunteer work on their behalf, and it's a relatively small contribution that's being sought here. So, they're doing a great job for our heritage cause at their own cost, and this is just a small thing to assist that. So that's what this is about. So I'm obviously got familiarity with it, so I'm happy for this to be referred to council to get the fuller information, but that's the long and the short of what.
Councillor Wilkinson, I do suggest that you've put it up as a motion. It's been seconded. There are budget implications to this. I do recommend that you do ask those questions before you put it up. That would be the wise thing to do, so we don't have the ambiguity and now five hands on the floor, which we all have to ask questions. You're keeping your motion as is, points 1, 2, and 3?
Yeah.
Okay. Councillor Martin, you're the seconder.
I reserve my right.
Councillor Sims.
I do understand Councillor Wilkinson's desire to want to fund these kind of projects. I guess we are in a very difficult position because of the decision of this council to freeze the rates, which has, you know, constrained our ability to deal with these kind of projects when they crop up. But I am concerned about the carry forward being used as kind of some de facto magic pudding, where we just kind of keep drawing on it to fund our pet projects. I mean, I actually think this is a worthy project, and it's not a huge amount of money, but, you know, there are quite a lot of potential worthy projects. From my perspective, the case hasn't really been made, and maybe there could be an opportunity to draw this from the Heritage Fund, which is quite substantial, and we have recently topped back up to $1 million. So we could perhaps potentially look at taking some money out of that fund to allocate to this project. I know it has a slightly different focus, Councillor Wilkinson, but I'm not really inclined to support this on the fly.
Councillor Sims, you're not putting any amendment?
Oh, well, I'm happy to. Should this motion fail, I'm happy to foreshadow that I'll move parts 1 and 2 as printed.
Okay. Councillor Abiad?
Thank you, Chair. Look, I'm not supportive of that change and that amendment. I don't even think Councillor Wilkinson knows what we're carrying forward, and it's already committed as the Chair of Finance. Those carry forwards are committed. So before members decide to pull numbers out of them, we need to have an appreciation and an understanding. And I know at the previous committee, we committed to a $50,000 increase in funding for heritage. That was also not committed. That needs to come back in a workshop for us to explain to administration how we function with that. So look, on the fly, motions like this and amendments like this, I will never support. I just need to note it here, unless it's a state of emergency, there's an issue, we're concerned, we're well educated on it. So just for some of the members that are moving or want to move things like that in the future, please keep in mind of trying to get us some information prior to a council meeting. Otherwise, you end up, risking the opportunity of having something worthwhile doing just simply because we didn't follow due process. And I've got some serious concerns around that, because we have a strategic plan, we have outcomes we're trying to achieve, and we need to make sure as a council, as a whole, that we're all on that same journey to achieve those outcomes. So look, I will not be supporting this today, and I urge members not to support it, because we need to follow due process.
Right, members, I've got Councillor Hendon, Moran and Martin. I'm assuming we're, I won't assume, Councillor Hendon.
Well, I also won't support this motion, and will support the foreshadowed motion. I didn't support the $50,000 carry forward for the Heritage Fund last time, and I'm not supporting this for the same reason. I think it's absolutely fine that we go back and have a look at our carry forwards, and if there's money there, then I think we need to look at it in strategic terms. We need to identify all the projects that we might want to fund out of our carry forward money and set priorities for them. And this might get up, it might be one of them, but it needs to be judged against the other things that might also get up. I also expect it's a great project. So it's not that I'm anti the project, I'm anti the process.
Councillor Moran?
Yes, look, I just want to correct misinformation that Hassam may have led to. It is absolutely outrageous to say this is against due process. This is not against due process. Any councillor has the right to put any motion they like. This is a committee, it's not council. I'd sort of slightly sympathise if it came in council. Councillor Wilkinson does not have to submit it in writing. He does not have to do his research before. That is what this committee is for, and I'm sick and tired of being wrapped over the knuckles, hard-working people on this council that work 18 hours a day, being told off by not putting it in print and so forth. You don't have to do that. It is also completely against the Local Government Act to say, but because you don't think the process was right, you are never going to vote for any motion that is presented to you in this way. That is absolutely shocking for a councillor to say that. You must vote for every motion put to you legally in this council on its merits, not because you didn't like the way it was put to you. Now, it would be handy to have a bit more information here, but we will have that by the time we get to the council meeting. We can vote this through now. If there are no carry forwards available, obviously there won't be carry forwards available, and this won't be able to be done. This is presumptive on the fact that there is enough in the carry forward. I think I urge you to vote for it. The National Trust, as Sandy said, is mainly done by volunteers. It does a fantastic job. It is only a small amount of money for this very worthy app. If it comes to us that we can't do it in the council meeting, then don't vote against that. But it really annoys me when people say, this is such a fantastic program, but I won't be voting for that because I don't like the process. I don't like this and I don't like that. If you think it's a fantastic project, you should vote for it. And then we'll work out, well, you don't know that. You don't know where the money, that information will come. But this is an in principle support of that project. When we get more information, then you can point to something that you won't vote for. But without the knowledge, I think you are compelled to vote for it if you think it's good and worthy. You can't say, I don't think the money's there. Hassam doesn't, you're on the finance committee, you must know more about it than I do. But $10,000, we are a big fat organisation with a lot of buckets, and you will be able to find that money. We found it for the Rainbow Crossing, we can find it for this. And I tell you which one I'd rather have, really.
All right. Now, members, please, I just urge you to talk to the recommendation that is before us. Councillor Martin.
Yeah, Chair, I will talk to the recommendation before us, but a lot of the discussion has not been about the recommendation. Your comments and others have been about the process and the manner in which this is raised, and therefore I will address those comments. I am just stunned at the amount of time that we waste discussing the expenditure of small amounts for worthy causes. This is $10,000. Now, we're going to spend the best part of 10 minutes on this. We had a meeting a few weeks ago of the Finance and Business Services Committee, and it was presented to us that the administration had not spent $25.6 million of the money that was allocated to them in 2014-15, asking us to approve the repayment of debt by $3 million and approve carry forwards which were not allocated to anything, amounting to more than $300,000, and a capital works program amounting to $22.6 million. It went through like that. There wasn't a debate. There wasn't a discussion. If I hadn't raised it, it would have gone through without a word. And here we are talking about $10,000 for a deserving organisation for a heritage app that dovetails with everything that we're doing. Spare me, spare me. Please endorse this and let's stop the nonsense.
I'll just clarify one thing, Councillor Martin. I didn't make any comments. I've not spoken to this item, so just to clarify. I've just been reassured that Councillor Cobell got you next, that the administration are going to clarify exactly what we've already agreed to for this project and get some clarity to between now and the council meeting. I've got Councillor Cobell, then the Lord Mayor.
Look, I recognise that Councillor Wilkinson has undertaken maybe some work. He's connected to the volunteers that have worked on this. But I actually don't know much about the National Trust Online Heritage app. I don't know anything about it. I don't know what it looks like. I don't know how long they've been working on it for. I don't know who's pulled it together. I don't know how much money has been thrown into this already. I don't know when it's going to be online, even if we throw some money at it. I want some more information. If we're voting on this, I want some more information. Can that be provided?
Yes, is the answer to that question from administration. A briefing memo will be, or some information will be given. Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I've got my concerns about how this has been brought to committee, but I'll park that for a minute. In principle, I think it's a good idea. I'll support it. But it'll be subject to administration clarifying just a number of matters. And I think Councillor Corbell has illustrated pretty well all of my concerns in one. But I also just want some comfort around Councillor Wilkinson's role with the National Trust, just to ensure there's no conflicts here. And I just want some robust assurances around that from administration, if not through Councillor Wilkinson.
Well, Lord Mayor, just to clarify that, sorry, it's up to Councillor Wilkinson to declare his own conflicts of interest.
Okay, well, I'd seek those assurances prior to Council.
It's up to Councillor Wilkinson, should he choose to or not.
Okay.
Councillor Wilkinson, Lord Mayor has the floor. You can choose at any time to declare a conflict of interest. It's your call whether you do or not. You can talk about it when you sum up.
So I'll reserve my right for the vote in the chamber, but I'll support you in this instance.
Right. Do I have any Councillor Clarahan?
Given the comments made by some of our members and just most recently by the Lord Mayor, I'm wondering whether I could move a motion, an amendment to that part three.
I'm just wondering who. You've only got.
There's no amendment
to be
made.
Two people could second it. Yep. Okay. Most people have spoken. But
and I would like some assistance with the work.
Well, Councillor Clarahan, what's your amendment?
I'm just waiting until I get attention from other members, thank you.
Fair call.
And that would be number three, as written, subject to receipt of further information prior to Tuesday's council meeting.
Can I
or further information from administration. I'm just trying to give us a way of addressing this without actually committing to it totally, where we can have an out, or alternatively we take it in parts.
Councillor, before you speak to her,
need a seconder.
That's correct. Now, can I just make a suggestion to you? I understand where you're trying to head here. Do you want to just remove the words out of 1415 carry forwards to come back with more potential funding options? I'm just giving you, because you're trying to keep it generic and open to get an outcome. I can see what you're trying to do. So can I suggest that you do that?
Yes,
and
I'm
then
happy
I'll
to
call
do that.
For it'll either be Councillor Slam or Antic. Councillor Antic. Yeah. I need you to concentrate now. I need you if they're the only two that haven't spoken. If I'm correct on that. So do I get a seconder on the amendment? Councillor Slam has seconded the amendment. Thank you. Councillor Clarahan, now you can talk to your amendment.
Look, this very well may be a very good project, a very worthwhile project. Most of what the National Trust has done with in partnership with council has been very good work, but I think we're not in a position to totally support this without the further information about it in terms of what we've already contributed, if anything, and if that's the project on page 77 that's made reference to, the National Trust Adelaide's Architecture and Heritage Online. Is that, I'm assuming that's the project, but given there's not much information here, I think we do need the extra information so that we can make a final decision at next week's council meeting.
Right, Councillor Clarahan, I'm just going to park your comments there because we have 20 seconds to open up the next committee meeting. So I'm just going to call for adjournment. Do I have a mover? Councillor Sims, second to Councillor Clarahan. Put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried.
At 6:30, I announce the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee open and call for an adjournment.
So moved.
Taken by Councillor Clarahan, second by Councillor Moran. All those in favour of the adjournment? That's carried. I now adjourn the meeting and return back to the planning.
Thank you. I reopen the Strategy, Planning and Partnerships Committee meeting. We are on agenda item number 10. Councillor Slammer as the seconder to the amendment. Do you wish to speak? Do I have any other speakers to the amendment? You can ask a question.
So according to our information here, is this part of the motion that Councillor Wilkinson is referring to refers to task National Trust Adelaide Architecture and Heritage Online, where it says it's an external request for an ongoing maintenance and upgrade cost of $10,000 for the online. Is that what that is?
That's what we're asking.
That's a question through to administration. Is
that what it is that he's referring to, or is it the development of the app? That's what I'm confused.
I think...
Can I get some clarification?
Deputy Lord Mayor, one thing is that the administration are going to come back to us and give exact clarity about our existing commitment to this project. But Councillor Wilkinson, there is some further clarity you could perhaps shed on this around your funding proposal is specifically for the app development, is it? Use your mic, please. Use your microphone, please.
It is that which is in the box in page 77 of the report that is listed as to be not funded, and my motion is that it is funded. That's as simple.
Okay. I think that is quite clear, actually. Right, I'm putting the amendment, members. All those in favour of the amendment? All those against? I declare the amendment carried. That is a substantive. Councillor Wilkinson... Yes, good. Councillor Wilkinson, would you like to sum up on...
Summed up.
Can we not speak on the substantive?
You've already spoken, Councillor Hendrick.
I spoke on the amendment, I thought.
No, you have not. You've spoken on the substantive.
You should have spoken before we summed up.
The only person that hasn't spoken now is Councillor Slammer, who reserved his right, but he did second, and Councillor Antic. So technically you've spoken, Councillor Slammer. Are you summing up, Councillor Wilkinson? I'll put that, members. All those in favour? All those against? Declare. Can I get that again? All those in favour? All those against?
You're not voting.
Any to vote against?
So clearly, everyone put your hand up. All those in favour, I need to count. All those against. It's like 6-5. Yeah, carried. 7-5. Do I have any other business? No.
Something. Anything.
Well, I think that's the
10 grand for something.
That's it. Excellent. Thank you. Thanks, members, for your time. I'll close the meeting.
Members, I call open, re-adjourn the infrastructure and public... Reopen, my apologies. The infrastructure and public space committee. The infrastructure and public space committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country, the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains, and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Apologies and leave of absence. All present. Confirmed. Item 3, confirmation of minutes. I have a mover to confirm the minutes. Councillor Sims, Councillor Moran to second. All those in favour of the minutes? Those opposed, that's carried. Public forum. We have no public forum, thank you. Chair's verbal report, I have no verbal report to make. Items for adoption on block. Item 7, funding deed under the Commonwealth Infrastructure Investment Black Spot Program. Item 8, Town Hall Function Centre and Civic Areas, proposed carpet renewal plans. Councillor Martin. Report distributed separately on that item. Item 9, invigorate your senses, Topham Mall, Bentham Pit and Weymouth Street pilot area. Item 10, community consultation findings, Brown Hill Creek Stormwater Project Part B. Okay, we'll pull, as a chair, I will call that item out so that Councillor Antic can leave the room for the vote on that item. Okay, so I now put items. Okay, I now put for the items 7 and 9 to be taken on block. Do I have a mover? Councillor, Deputy Lord Mayor Abiyad, seconded Councillor Slama. All those in favour of those items on block? All those opposed? That's carried. Come back to item 8, Councillor Martin, Town Hall Function Centre, Civic Areas Carpet.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I'm not going to move this. Could somebody else move it? I want to ask a question.
Move, Councillor Clarahan, seconded Councillor Milani.
We were, it's inferred in the paper, to be given some illustrations of what is proposed, that is samples. Is that to proceed? Oh, okay. And is there an explanation to accompany them?
Perhaps if I could call on council staff to show the pictures and the samples for members to see. This is quite important. This is what the whole floor of the town hall is going to be like upstairs, and a lot of work and research has gone into it. We have Andrew Clankey from Swanby Penglaze Architects, who's a heritage architect. Perhaps. Is that Phil Rowland?
Yes.
Yeah. And we've got also Phil Rowland and Helen involved in this project. So perhaps if we could ask on Phil and Andrew Clankey to speak to the proposal.
Okay, I've got Andrew Clankey from Swandry Penglaze, who have been involved with the State Parliament recarpeting a similar heritage building to the Town Hall, and he's just going to talk about some of the inspiration and the generators of the carpet master plan for the Town Hall.
Thank you. As a bit of background, the process has been initiated. We were initially asked to be involved to look at, due to our previous work that we did at Old Parliament House and Parliament House, where we followed a similar process. Basically, a brief was prepared for looking at design for new carpets for the function centre on the first and the second floor, and as well as the carpeting of all the civic areas. As part of this process, a company was commissioned, engaged basically, to assist with the design work as well as the manufacture and the installation of the carpet. The design work is for the entire, all the carpet for the civic area as well as the function centre, but the installation at present is only for the function centre with a separate price for the Queen Adelaide room. As a bit of background, The company that was engaged is Brinton's Carpet. They'd have to be one of the, they have about a 230-year history in carpet design and manufacture, very knowledgeable, have an incredible history and library, as well as very good understanding of textile design, which is quite an important area in itself. In terms of a bit of background, as part of this process, we did quite a bit of research work on floor coverings that were installed in the town hall previously. Unfortunately, there's not a great deal of information. People tended not to take photographs of carpets and things like that, so it's very difficult to determine. One thing that we are aware of was that the when the town hall opened in 1866, its major public spaces, circulation spaces, were finished with Minton's ornamental tiles. And I think as part of the presentation, the information that you've got some illustrations there of Minton's ornamental tiles. They were the best sort of tiling at the time. Quite a new introduction to South Australia that only occurred in the 1860s. But other major public buildings at the time had similar floor finishes. For example, the main auditorium in the GPO, which was finished slightly later, Supreme Court, and a lot of the bank buildings. But in some of the illustrations we've got, give you some examples of some of the others. St George's Hall is the main building that we've got in there in Liverpool, which is a fabulous floor done by Minton's. For example, the Palace of Westminster and the Capitol building in Washington, D.C. also had Minton's ornamental tiles. So it was a very traditional form of tiling for major public buildings.
That's in attachment E, in case you're searching for it. There's a carpet design. So that's the one that shows all the visuals.
Part of the research, otherwise, we can determine from what we know that most of the floor coverings in the town hall were relatively simple by comparison, either boards or oil cloths and linoleum when that became available. For example, the council chamber itself was only carpeted in 1938. Prior to that, it actually had linoleum on the floor, polished the linoleum. The first carpet installed in the town hall, from the information we're able to determine, was 1890. And that was in the Lord Mayor's reception room, which is now the Lord Mayor's office. So here we go. So we've got St George's Hall there on the right, and the detail of the tiles on the floor. All of these are examples of Minton's ornamental tiles. So a couple of images from the town hall. Image on the right is actually the encaustic tiles that's in the public foyer space outside of the current council chamber. Those tiles were installed in 1916. Unfortunately, the Minton's tiles don't appear to have survived, and we can't find any images of them. But the images on the left are actually the town hall foyer before the current stair was installed. And the extension it went through into the Prince Alfred Hotel from the 1950s. And it's a bit hard to see in that previous image, but you can see the encaustic tiles on the floor if you happen to zoom in. The lower image is actually the first floor foyer. So that's the doors on the right, the doors that currently lead directly into the auditorium. So you can, yes, if you see the floor up there, you can see the encaustic tiles on the floor. The lower image is the foyer, and it's a bit hard to see because they're demolishing everything at the moment, so that's actually dust on the floor. But that is effectively a tiled floor as well. The town hall motif in the middle. So using that information, we proceeded to look at a number of different options for the carpet with Brinton's. We explored probably about 70 to 80 different designs initially, and from those we narrowed down to about six, but we ended up narrowing it further down to two options, which we explored in a bit more detail. Out of those, the decision was made to actually explore the option that we actually have in front of you with these hand trials, which is effectively a geometric design, which our view is it's picking up the similar themes to the encaustic tiles that were in all the major public circulation spaces originally. Also, this design is very flexible, so it allows us to look at different ways. The foyer around the auditorium is very complicated. It's a sort of a combination of spaces, and each of those areas really need to be treated slightly differently. And this design allows that flexibility, so we can treat it in slightly different ways. Unfortunately, those images are very difficult to see, so this looks black there, unfortunately. But the colour palette is we weren't able to find any information about colours that had been used on earlier floor coverings. So we, as a theme, we actually used the colours of the City of Adelaide, which is blue and gold. So that was the basis for selecting the palette. So we looked at a number of deep blues and basically golds and bronzes as a theme. And they work really well with the other materials in the space also. And also the practicalities of the carpet that needs to be in the foyer, because it takes a huge amount of traffic, and also is because it's used for catering purposes, it's important to actually have a carpet that's properly has a degree of patterning in it, as well as particularly dark colours, because they actually help to hide soiling. They're better at hiding soiling. If we can go back to the previous, can we go back to the previous slide? Sorry, one more before that. Well, this is picking up some of the design motifs that are actually in the foyer area as well, so you can see some of the similarities in terms of the shapes and details. Can we go to the slide before that? So this is looking at the colour palette and the other how it works with the other materials. In the space, we have basically the polished timber, which is quite prominent, as well as the bluestone sidewalls, the original external sidewalls of the auditorium itself. So you can see how that palette actually works with those materials. I should also explain that the reason why we've gone down this path, ideally we would be presenting designs for all of the areas, but the main situation we have at the moment is the window of opportunity to actually install new carpet in the foyer of the function centre is between Christmas and early New Year this year. And as a result, it does mean to meet the timeframes to fit in with the looms and actually the production of the carpet and to be here in Adelaide in time, we actually have to have the carpet signed off and back in Melbourne on the 17th of September. So although ideally we would have designs for everything, we've had to fast track this design to actually meet that time frame. So at present, certainly the intention, I understand it's very important to actually look at the unity of the carpet throughout the building, and that's certainly the intention of how it's all being designed and looked at. I should explain this design is not something that we would then replicate everywhere through all the other areas. This is a design that will be specific to the foyer space. How it relates to some of the other areas may be, for example, we're looking at actually taking the outer field design and running into, for example, the banqueting room. Also, this design will run through the smaller function spaces, such as the Prince Alfred room and the Green room, David Spence room. So hopefully that provides some information.
Councillor Martin, please.
Yeah, look, a couple of questions. You would use this, though, in other parts of the building as well, wouldn't you? I mean, it is suitable for that, so that there's some uniformity.
Quite possibly, we may well be using a similar design to this. The advantage we have is we can change the scale of the design too. So For example, this may be a design that we particularly pick up and use for the corridor spaces down in the civic area. And the intention is certainly, thematically, this is the sort of design that we'll be putting elsewhere. But some of the spaces, for example, the council chamber and the Queen Adelaide room, I'm not sure this might, or even this space, might not be the most appropriate design for these areas. This is actually for the west foyer section, the section that we've got here, which is probably the most elaborate version of it. Some of the versions we have for the side foyers are simplified, and they may be something that we pick up. It's basically the same design but modified, and they may be similar things that we use elsewhere as well.
And what about, you may have read, we have trouble with surfaces here at Adelaide City Council. Is this resilient? It doesn't get, well, slip-proof, yes, but it doesn't, it's not likely to deteriorate over a short period of time?
No, I can guarantee this is a, the specification actually calls up a very heavy grade of commercial grade carpet. So this is an 80% wall, 20% nylon, which is a standard Axminster specification, but it's a very high density. The design that will actually be produced, it's about a 51-ounce carpet, so it's a very durable carpet. This is a carpet that is widely used in the hospitality industry, so it's the most common carpet for very robust use. For example, it's used widely for hospitality purposes, so it's ideal for this situation.
And would you anticipate it has a life of 10 years, 5 years, 15?
I think we've actually said 15 to 20 years is the life expectancy. Depending on how you look after it, it can last a lot longer. For example, there was an Axminster in the Queen Adelaide room installed in 1916, and from what I can see, it lasted until about 1950. So,
okay,
gives you an idea of. I'm not sure how what condition it was in when it was replaced in 1950, but.
Councillor Moran.
I'll just move it, so it's already been moved.
Right. Okay. Councillor Hender.
Just a couple of quick questions. This has to be manufactured overseas. I'm assuming that's because there isn't a manufacturer capable of doing it. Is there anything Australian about it at all? For example, is there any Australian wool in there, or don't we know?
No, there's no Australian wool in it.
Okay.
Australia isn't very good at producing wool suitable for carpets.
Okay.
So our wools are very suitable for clothing purposes, but unfortunately, the sort of wool that needs to be produced for carpet are really coarse wools, which that's the reason why England was traditionally so suitable for producing carpets. So it's usually the really coarse breed English wools that are suitable. Some of the wool may be from New Zealand, because New Zealand also produces some suitable carpet wools, but unfortunately we've explored that and nobody produces.
Okay, so it's been fully explored.
It has been fully explored.
My next question relates to furnishing. Does that mean we're going to have to recover a whole lot of furnishings as well? I mean, if you think about that, I know you wouldn't lay that in this room necessarily, but the colour palette.
Looks good.
With the red chairs and like, does
in the 5-year renewal plan, we have got allowances for the function centre to look at renewing some of their furniture, which is actually very aged at the moment. But I think we'd have to look at some of the council chamber and Colonel Light room separately to see what colour we end up with here, because it may not be exactly that palette, I think.
So, no. Well, I guess my question is there a hidden cost that we've yet to see associated with laying this now, because are we also going to have to find some money for the...
No, not in the function centres, which are the first areas, because we already have that built into a 5-year renewal programme to look at their... I think they've got green chairs up there at the moment, which are beyond the end of life.
Okay. And the last thing is, can any of the previous carpet be... reused, particularly there's a rather lovely motif bit in the middle. Is any of that reusable?
Yes, we're actually saving the feature panels, which were an artistic commission, and think they're going to be stored in archives with the possibility of being reused in some of our community centres or other buildings.
Lovely. Thank you.
Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. I was fortunate enough to have a brief briefing on this last week. I think this is a terrific piece of work. Thank you for this very detailed report. I've learnt a great deal about Town Hall by reading this report, let alone its soft furnishings. But and of course, Town Hall next year celebrates 150 years. The City of Adelaide, of course, 175, no, Town Hall, the building. So 150 for Town Hall. So I think the timeliness of this is entirely appropriate, and I think this will present Town Hall in its best light. So good work. Thank you.
Just from the Chair, I'd just like to ask a couple of questions, and I thank you for the very thorough research and particularly comprehensive answering of Councillor Hender's question about the origin of the wall. I've never heard such an impressive response on matters of such. Now, if you look at page 57, where it's had the picture of the carpet panel itself on the screen, can we have that? Well, there's that image showing the colours of the bluestone, and there's a view of the carpet pattern, that there. The bluestone in the photo is sort of a deeper, duller sort of blue.
Yes.
And the picture that we see there has a more subdued, sort of deeper, duller, sort of little bit less sort of bright. Is it possible for us to sort of give this the okay, but sort of say we'd like a slightly deeper, duller kind of thing? Is that possible for us to do that with a supplier, with the program that you're working on? What are your thoughts on that?
It is possible. In actual fact, the next round of hand trials, these required some modification. The next round of hand trials are actually due next Monday. Mm-hmm. So I think the intention is that we would actually present them at the council meeting next Tuesday. We have actually called up for a revised colour palette, which is actually muted down. So we've explored that as an option. Mm-hmm. So we should be able to present that at the next council meeting.
Which is Monday, I'm advised.
Is it Monday, is it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Might not be here.
Well, I understand it's arriving Monday, so I'm hopeful it will be here in time.
Okay, thank you.
So, but the hand trials actually do come from England, so yeah, there is a bit of travelling time in doing that. So, a bit of a challenge to dramatically change things. What we are looking at is basically keeping the design and everything, but just basically toning down, particularly the golds and the bronzes, as an alternative option. Mm.
There's a deeper blue option.
A deeper blue, so it's a darker blue that's being looked at, so sort of an indigo colour. Mm. So, unfortunately, we won't see them until you see them as well. So, we're hopeful that it's going to be successful. So,
thank you very much. Does anyone else have any questions? Move back to the mover, the sum up.
Just very quickly, I wanted to say thank you to all those people who've been involved. It's been a long and very, very thorough process. It's not an easy thing to do, knowing that there's going to be a flow-on effect throughout all the civic rooms here in the Town Hall. And also the reference to historically what was there in terms of the tiles, it's been incredibly thorough. The other thing I think we need to realise too is that the functionality of the carpet for different spaces, and obviously the west wing up in the foyer outside of the auditorium is used very heavily for functions, be they weddings or art exhibitions or whatever. and they need to be. It needs to be a very serviceable carpet in terms of its colour and design. And there's been a lot of consideration by people, by our manager Trevor, in the function centre about the suitability. So it hasn't been just about looks. It's also been about function and the ability to sort of continue on the design or elements of that design throughout the rest of the town hall. So I just wanted to say thank you to all of those people. They've taken the responsibility very seriously and have worked incredibly long and hard on bringing this design to fruition. So I'm very happy to support the work to date and look forward to the new samples on Monday.
Okay, and as Chair, I'd just like to echo my gratitude for the thoroughness of that research, which has been superbly executed, and there's things down for a long time. We want to get it right, and I think we couldn't have done a better job in terms of that. Thank you. I now put the motion. Those in favour? Those opposed? Approved. Thank you. Carried. I now move on to item 10. Councillor Antic, I'd like to. Yeah, Councillor Antic, if you could please, before you leave the room, identify your interest, please, in the matter. You need. For the record, you need to state your interest.
Whether it's a conflict or not, I'm doing it on the side of caution that our firm, which I've employed, acts for some of the residents of a different council area, but notwithstanding, have an interest in the matter. So,
thank you. Noted. Do I have a mover, Councillor Moran? A seconder? Do I have a seconder? Councillor Slama? Have any discussion? Councillor Moran? Councillor Slama? Any discussion? I put the motion. As opposed? Carried. Thank you. Councillor Antic could come back for the next item, please. Out of session papers for committee to receive, nil. Other business? Any other business members? No other business. Next item 13, to exclusion to consider. Item 14, moved by Councillor Moran, the exclusion, seconded by the Lord Mayor. Those favouring the exclusion? Those opposed? That's carried. I now ask all those not associated with this item to depart the room, please.
in the city today. This is not part of the formal council meeting.